Joining me now, the co-author of the Politico piece that broke this news, Josh Gerstein. Josh, this is a scoop of a lifetime and a decision that will have repercussions potentially for generations. Let me just read you the draft of the decision that you obtained. Quote from Samuel Alito, "We hold that Roe and Casey must be overruled. The Constitution makes no reference to abortion, and no such right is implicitly protected by any constitutional provision." The impact, Josh, of those words.
Yeah, John, good morning. When we read those words, I have to say, when I first read them, you kind of stop in your tracks. It's a very bold statement. It's talking about reversing a half century of precedent here in the United States, guaranteeing women across the country in every state in the nation, at least in theory, the right to an abortion. And to see those words, it's very stark, I think, to read them. It is stunning when you first do so. It's surprising, I think, to see it in this format that looks a lot like a final Supreme Court opinion. But I do think, John, if you step back and you think about the decades-long effort by conservatives and conservative legal activists to build up their numbers on the court, you think about the fact that former President Donald Trump managed to get three nominations and confirmations of very conservative justices to the Supreme Court, in part because of maneuvers by Senator Mitch McConnell and others. In that sense, maybe it's not that surprising. You could say this has been a long day coming, despite the way the words strike you when you first read them.
It is the culmination of efforts, as you say, decades in the making that accelerated in new ways over the last several years, and the impact is very, very real. By some estimates, we can put up a map, I think, so people can see. This would, if this draft opinion becomes the real opinion, this means that these states you're seeing in red there would almost immediately outlaw or severely restrict abortion rights, and the ones in yellow could potentially do the same. So it would have a very large impact. Josh, before we get much further on this, just let's make clear exactly what you obtained and the significance of the fact that you have this draft opinion. What is a draft opinion?
So when the Supreme Court hears arguments in a case, usually within 1, 2, or 3 days after that, they have a closed-door private conference. Only the nine justices inside that conference room, very secretive room at the Supreme Court. And each of them basically lays out their position on each case. And at that point, there is an effort to assign a majority opinion. Typically, the majority opinion is assigned by Chief Justice John Roberts or whoever the Chief Justice at the time is, if he is in the majority. And if not, it's the most senior of the other justices who's in the majority. And our understanding is that what happened in this case is that the opinion was assigned to Justice Samuel Alito, and he and his clerks have spent the 2 months or 2.5 months between the arguments in December and mid-February preparing this opinion. It's 67 pages in text and then a 31-page appendix that was circulated at the court as a proposed majority opinion. According to a person familiar with the court's proceedings, this appears to have the support of 5 of the 6 Republican-appointed justices on the Supreme Court, essentially all the justices of the conservative persuasion on the court except for Chief Justice John Roberts. That's our best understanding of the situation. And we should make clear to viewers, it is a draft. It is labeled as a first draft right on it. And therefore, it could change before late June, which is typically when the Supreme Court releases its opinions in its most controversial and contentious cases.
It could change right up until the last minute. At the same time, based on your reporting and others, there isn't necessarily a reason to believe that it would change substantively, but we'll wait and see. Josh, I want to read more from this, again, because the language is so important, and in your piece, you point out exactly why. Samuel Alito writes in this draft, "Roe was egregiously wrong from the start." Why is that wording so important here in the overall argument he's making?
Well, so the reason that Alito's language is so tough and just so almost contemptuous of the ruling that was issued in 1973 is that I think he felt he really needed to build up a head of steam here to justify overturning precedent. You know, there is this presumption on the Supreme Court that its previous decisions were decided correctly and that they don't lightly overturn opinions that they've issued in the past, especially on matters of wide concern to the American public. This is not some trivia area of business or tax law. This is an issue that affects, you know, tens of millions, maybe more than 100 million Americans. And so what Alito tries to do here is to almost ridicule the Supreme Court's opinion in Roe v. Wade from 1973, which paints it as so trivial and so poorly reasoned that the court should not have qualms about striking it down. And that language about being egregiously wrong is very interesting if you trace it back in recent opinions of the court. That's the kind of thing they've used, for example, to overrule Plessy versus Ferguson, which was separate but equal in terms of racial discrimination. So he's trying to link it to a series of episodes in the past where the court has said, you know, we got an issue deeply, deeply wrong. Alito is saying we did that again. And it looks like he may well have a sufficient number of conservative allies on the court to make that the prevailing opinion, unless votes change. It may not just be wording. It is possible to see votes change, and we've seen that in very high-profile cases.
You know, you raise a great point. Yes, votes could change, but wording could certainly change. So when we're talking about this language here, some of this language can change in ways that does substantively alter, perhaps, the meaning of all this. There are those looking at this, Josh, again, raising questions about, well, is this ruling as written in this draft, does it only have an impact on abortion? Or could it have an impact on other decisions decided from the 60s, really in the 60s and the 70s, that found a certain right to privacy, starting with contraception, starting with interracial marriage, all the way up until same-sex marriage? Alito seemed to anticipate that criticism, didn't he?
Right. He tries to kind of ring-fence abortion in this opinion and repeatedly says, we're only talking about abortion here. This decision has no impact on any of those other decisions, which critics have said are based on more broad and vague themes in the Constitution, arguably. The word privacy not really appearing there. Obviously, the word abortion not appearing in that document drafted in the 18th century. But the question is, can you pluck abortion out of our jurisprudence and say, we're going to get rid of this right that we've had for a half a century and leave all those other things you mentioned, like contraception, for example, or the right to marry someone of a different race? Can you just say that those things are all going to remain and we just pull this one thing out? And you can even bring it forward to more recent decisions, for example, guaranteeing a right to same-sex marriage based in part on the same kinds of principles, that it's really no business of the government whether you choose to marry someone of opposite sex or the same sex. Will you be able to separate these issues and put abortion in a different box? This opinion refers to it as a decision concerning potential life, and that those other kinds of issues don't involve potential life. But obviously, many Americans might disagree, and I suspect that the dissents you'll see in this case are going to really zero in on that question of could this decision have a more dramatic impact despite the assurances that Alito tries to give in this draft opinion.
You know, Josh Gerstein from Politico, we are on the precipice of what looks to be an historic moment, and this is a scoop unlike any we have ever seen before. We appreciate you, as always, and we appreciate your work, Josh. Thank you.